coming from a very handsome gentleman, man of God, Pastor Allen. Let's give him a clap of praise.
Thank you, Nico. Okay, so before everything, okay, we're going to do an executive order this morning. All right? We're going to stand up all together as a church. And it's not only a God-mandated, but a president-mandated thing to do this morning, to pray for the nation, for Harvey. Amen? And after we pray, of course, we support people, we love people in prayer. We also want to follow that up with action, okay? So we're going to have baskets over here after we pray. Pray in your heart. What can you give? What do you want to give? How much you want to give? And there will be baskets here after we pray. You can start going to the front and give. All throughout this week, this church will be open. If you want to donate diapers, if you want to give water, if you want to give clothes, drop them off. And then we'll figure out a way to send that to Houston. Amen? All right, let's all bow our heads. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you that you are merciful. We thank you today that in humbling, Lord God, there is your hand moving. We thank you so much that your grace is abundant. You said in your word that your mercy triumphs over your judgment. And we thank you, Father God, that your mercy as rain has fallen so much in Houston. We pray that your mercy will fall doubly in Houston and the people over there. In the name of Jesus, we lift them up to you today in prayer, Father God. We remember our brothers and sisters in Houston. We pray that you will lead them to call upon your name. We pray, Father, that out of the suffering and the trial and the difficulty that they're going through right now, praise will come out of their lips. We pray that thanksgiving will come out of their mouths, Father God. We pray that their thoughts will be led to you, Jesus. That God, you strengthen their faith. We pray that you will sustain them at this moment. For every family who lost their homes. For every family and little children who's been displaced and are homeless now, Father God. For every elderly who've been moved around because of this. We pray, Father, that your hand will just move mightily upon them today. In the name of Jesus, we pray for your mercy. We pray for your grace, God. We pray for the gospel, God, to just be spread all over Houston right now. We pray for their hearts to be open so that they will hear and they will just believe and their hearts will be prepared to receive the good news of Jesus Christ in their lives. Father, we pray, Father God, for the men and women who are volunteering, helping over there today. Bless them, protect them, and keep them in the name of Jesus Christ. Even right now, supernaturally move. Let your angels, God, move and comfort. Let your angels just bring preparation, Father God, of gospel to be heard and be believed upon their lives in the name of Jesus. Today as a church, God, we declare, Father God, that you are the God of Houston. You are the God of this land. Though the enemy has... It may seem that he has done a havoc. We thank you that you work all things for the good of those who trust you. We declare today, Father God, that good, great things are going to be born out of this tragedy in the name of Jesus Christ. Even as families are displaced, we thank you and we declare that they will be aligned to the destiny that you have for their lives in the name of Jesus. We pray for the hopeless right now, that you give them hope. We pray for those who are losing faith, that you strengthen their faith in Jesus' name. We pray, Father, that the body of Christ over there and even over here will just come together to love, to show mercy and support for this great place of Houston. We commit this land to you. We thank you, God, that you are the God who's in control. You're never out of control. God, we thank you. We bless them today with our prayers. We strengthen them, God, with our prayers. We comfort them with our prayers today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Oh, okay. All right. So... Like I've said, if you are moved, if you want to give, our baskets are here. Please feel to do so. And while we're doing that, we have a video promotion for our Encounter God retreat next week, okay? And while you guys are coming to the front, we would like for you to see this, to encourage you, to invite people, to encourage you that lives are changed when we have an encounter with God. Amen. You guys ready? Thank you.
About 4
is she here? Where is she? Oh, there you are. Okay. So she used to go to church in Best Buy. Now she goes to church here. Okay. Praise God. So let's all bow our heads again. We will go straight into the Word. But before that, let's do something. As all of our heads are bowed down, we thank you that you are here. We declare that you are present in this place, Lord Jesus. We declare that your anointing is here. Declare that your Holy Spirit is here. And we just command our thoughts. We take authority over our thoughts, our emotions right now, our spirit, our soul, and body to be here in the name of Jesus. We rebuke any distractions that we're having in our thoughts, in our minds right now. And Father, will you stir up right now a hunger for what is God, a hunger for hearing your word, a hunger for a touch from you in Jesus' name. Will you stir that up in our hearts right now? Let every heart just be opened right now. Let every mind and emotion just be opened right now and be here in the present in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you that your word is powerful. We thank you that your word is alive and quick and sharp. And we allow your word, your glory this morning, your presence to shine upon every man and woman in this room and influence and impact our lives today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so today, it's Sunday, of course, and it's going to be EGR next week. Okay, and this is like, well, I always say this is like Christmas in River of Life when it's EGR. Everybody pulls together, everybody prepares together, because you know what? Something great happens when this weekend comes. Okay, people's hearts, they are changed. People's hearts, they are stirred up for hunger. Amen. Not only the delegates, but us as well. When we work, when we volunteer, there's something that we catch. There's something that we drink from. We take home and take away from here just by being here, you know? And it is so great. We encourage you, if you have not been to our EGR Encounter God Retreat, we encourage you to sign up, okay? Go to your small group leaders, go to your coaches. If you don't know who they are, just approach me after, or Pastor Cheryl after the service, okay? So today I'm going to share to you a word that is in relation to EGR. It's called, the word is behold. Okay, it's the theme of the Encounter God Retreat for next week. It's so amazing that whenever we have EGR, God speaks something. And we believe that when God speaks and gives a word, it's not just to have a theme. Okay, it's not just to have a caller. Or, okay, we're going to decide to how to design the stage because of the word that we're using. No. God gives us a word like this season. It's called behold, because there is something that's going to happen. And you know, in the Bible, whenever God gets ready to do something, he sends a word to prepare his people. Why? Because he wants his people to receive and not miss what he's going to do. So if you are here today, be hungry to grasp this word. Be hungry to take hold of this word, because for those who will hear it and grab it and take it home with them, they're going to partake of the things that God is going to do. You know, in the gospel, many of the people heard Jesus preach. They heard the word Jesus preach, but not all of them believed, because not all of them grabbed it. Not all of them were ready to believe it. Not all of them were ready to engage and partake of that word. Amen. And I pray that this morning, for every man and woman sitting in this room, that all of us are just ready. And I pray that God will bring us to a point where we're just so tired of what's going on in our normal lives. We just get tired of what's ordinary. We get tired of, you know, we think we're living life, but we're not, when we're missing the move of God, the activity of God, and the voice of God in our lives. Amen? So today the word is behold, okay? But before we go to that, let me tell you, at one point in your life and in my life, we have experienced how to be, I would say, beholden, to be captured by something. Amen. You know, we have an idea what it means to experience being beheld by something. Your emotion is captured, your thought is captured. It's like when a woman or when a man meets a woman and she's so beautiful, okay? That man keeps looking at that woman. Right, man? Yes. If you're sitting next to your wife, you better answer right and correct. Okay? When I first met Pastor Cheryl, okay, you know what happened from there. That was 19 years ago, right? I couldn't, you know, take my eyes off her. I keep thinking about her. I write letters. I think about her, you know. That's what happened when you're captivated by something, by somebody, okay? Or if you're a young man, you go to a car lot, and then you're looking at this car lot, multiple of cars, you're buying your first car, and then you see that car, that yellow or red car on the corner, and suddenly all the thousands of cars around it, they fade away. And your eyes just gets fixed on this yellow car named Bumblebee. And you think about it, you see yourself driving it, you see yourself cleaning, oh, this is what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna change the wheels, I'm gonna put this, I'm gonna do this. Okay? Because you started beholding that car. Amen. And so you know, when God gives the word to us, when he says, behold, when he says to you, behold, river of life, there's something good that's in front of us. There is something good, there is something great in front of us that we need to stop and pause and be still and allow our hearts to be captured by it. Because if we don't get captured by what God is bringing, we're not going to be thinking about it. We're not going to be investing our lives into it. Amen. So, behold, you've heard this word many times in the Bible, okay? Sometimes they use it in a dramatic way, behold, and then they start showing something, okay? But in the Bible, if I can get this thing to work, can you just move it for me, please? Okay. The word behold, okay, it means to call your attention to something. When God says behold, in this season, he wants to call your attention. He wants to get your attention because there's something spectacular. There's something great that's going to happen. He wants us to be aware. Behold, this is happening over here. Be aware of it. Behold, perceive what's going on, what's going to happen. Amen? He wants us to turn our eyes, our mind, and our attention. I prayed for that prayer a while ago because we could be here, but our thoughts are somewhere else. Amen? Amen. See? Yeah, I don't know if any of you caught that because you didn't say amen. Are you somewhere else? You need to come back here, bro. This is church. Okay? You need to come back here this morning. You need to behold what God is going to do in this place. Okay? It means turn your eyes and your mind and attention to something, to a person. Whenever Jesus Christ was going to do something, whenever God is going to do something, he sends an angel, and the angel starts with behold. Okay? In other words, behold means don't miss this. Don't miss this. Something great is going to happen. Something good is going on. Something good and delicious is cooking. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. We miss it by not looking. We miss it by being distracted. We miss it by not paying attention. We miss it because we disregard it. We miss it because there's something that we think is more important and we're so preoccupied with it. We get so preoccupied with this something over here that we miss what God wants us to behold. Amen? In the Bible, you know, there's a lot of moments and instances when God said, behold. Okay, and among these are this. In Psalm 133, it says, behold how good, how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. Pay attention. Don't miss that, he says. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be unto you all people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Merry Christmas. It's already September. Who loves Christmas? Okay, good. It's already September, so behold, Okay? Hopefully the weather's gonna get cooler soon. Behold, I am making all things new. Pay attention. I am making all things new. Don't miss it. Behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work. Behold, the Lion of Judah, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David has conquered. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Behold, all things are passed away. Behold, all things are new. There's so many great promises that God is bringing our attention to, so that when we don't pay attention to them, we miss them. Yes, we get saved, we go to church, but we do not fully enjoy the great things, the spectacular things that God wants to bring us into. Did you know that the God that we serve, the God I follow, TGIF, is not an ordinary God? He is a spectacular God. He's a passionate God. He's a good God. He's a faithful God. He's a generous God. Strong, mighty, powerful. And once you start beholding him, all these things, they manifest into your life. Amen? When we stop beholding him, we miss all these things. We live an ordinary life. We live a safe life. How many of you want a safe life? How many of us wants a secured life? How many of us wants to live our lives safely, meaning you don't want to take risk, you don't want to step by faith? Because in stepping by faith, that's when the supernatural comes. Amen. All right. So, first thing, okay? God, the word for this season is behold. What do we behold? We behold Jesus. The person of Jesus. Pastor Cheryl was saying how she got this word. I think she's going to tell this to you next week, but can I tell them now? Okay, good. I want to steal her thunder. Okay, so on EGR, she was sitting at the back, the last EGR, and she was just watching. She'll give you the details. She's a woman of details. I'm just giving you the general picture. Okay, so she said she was at the back. She was watching everybody worship. And then suddenly she heard the word, look at me. And then that was the Holy Spirit. It's an impression. And then that's how she got the word, behold. Okay? So many times we just watch what's going on around us. And then God is saying to us, this is a season where we need to fix our gates. Hello. This is the moment. It's September 2017. I don't know where you are in life right now. I don't know your life goals are. I don't know your timetable, but God has his timetable for you. God has his plan and purpose for you, which are so much greater than what you have on your list. But there is a need for us to just pause, lay down your list, and behold the person who's designed that purpose for you. Nobody else knows you better than him. I know your parents will say, I know my son, and your son will say, my parents know me, but nobody knows you better than the one who made you. And isn't he worthy to stop by for and just behold his person? Behold his glory. Behold who he is. Be captured. Be attentive. Don't miss him. Don't miss what he's saying. Don't miss what he's giving. Don't miss what he's bringing. Amen. In 2 Corinthians, let's read this. It's a little, it's going to be a little bit of verses, but let's go read it patiently, okay? 2 Corinthians 3:18 and on, starting at 12. Therefore, since we have such hope, we use great boldness of speech. Unlike Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the children of Israel could not look steadily at the end of what was passing. Away. But their minds were blinded, for until this day, the same veil remains unlifted in reading of the Old Testament, because the veil is taken away in Christ. Meaning, in short, this is what they're saying. Back in the days of Moses, the people's minds and hearts were veiled. They couldn't behold. They couldn't see. Okay? But now the veil has been lifted. But even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil lies in their hearts. Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. When you turn to the Lord, when you got saved, when you got born again, when you made Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior, that veil has taken away, and new birth and your, I will say, conversion gave you power to see. Amen. When you receive Christ in your heart, when you receive new life, you were given power to see. In John 3:3, it says, Jesus and Nicodemus were talking, and Jesus said to Nicodemus, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So when we got born again, we start seeing. Okay, we were given the power to see. We were given the power to behold. So don't say it. Don't believe the lie that, oh, you know what, I just got saved yesterday. I just got saved last Friday. I don't know how to behold. I don't know how to do this. Yes, you are. You are a child of God. Your inheritance is to see and behold the goodness and the glory of God. There is power in beholding. Okay? Let's keep reading. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Okay? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. When the Spirit of God is in this place, there's freedom. When you have the Spirit of God in you, there's liberty, there's freedom. But we all, here he goes, with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of God. It's like we're beholding as in a mirror. We're looking face to face. Have you used the mirror this morning? Before, of course, especially the women. Okay? Before you came to church, okay, maybe 30 minutes of that preparation was in front of the mirror. Okay? And you were just looking at your reflection. You were preparing yourself. And that's how we are. Okay? With unveiled face, beholding us in the mirror, the glory of the Lord. And while we are beholding, what's happening when we are beholding? When we're looking at Jesus, we are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just by the Spirit of the Lord. It's a lot of verses, but it really falls down on that last verse. Okay? But just to give us an understanding of what we're talking about. When we behold Christ, when we allow our hearts to fix our gaze on Him, what happens? We get changed. We get transformed. Not according to the models of this world, not according to those beautiful women and men on the magazine's front cover, but according to the image of Jesus. Who wants to be like Jesus here? I want to be like Jesus. Amen. When I treat my wife, I want her to see Jesus in me. When I deal with my children, I want them to see Jesus in me. When I go to work, I want to represent Jesus. I may not be preachy when I go to work, but I want them to see Jesus Christ's character in me. Because when you look on that reflection in the mirror, you look long enough, you become like Him, and you go out, they see what you've been looking at. Amen? So many times we have tried changing, and we've been struggling to change ourselves. And we will hear words like, hey, because you're a Christian, you don't do that. You're a Christian. Okay? You go to church, why do you still do that? And then there's a pressure to change. How many times have we promised, Lord, I promise this is the last time? And then the following week, Lord, really, that was not the last time. This is gonna be the last time, really. And then a month after, Lord, I promise this will be the last. And in His mercy and His grace, He hears us. In His mercy and in grace, He looks at us with eyes of love. He doesn't condemn us because He knows we're weak. He knows that we're men. We're made of sand. But it doesn't stop there. He put His Spirit inside of us so that now we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. But change doesn't have to be a effort. Change doesn't have to be a struggle. Change happens when we start looking. Change happens when we start beholding. And I believe that God released that word for this church in this moment, in this season, because something needs to happen in our lives. Amen. Something needs to happen in our lives. A lot of things are going on in the world right now. There's hurricanes. There's storms. You know, people who don't believe God, they are openly and boldly declaring what they believe. They're not in hiding anymore about their disbelief in God. And that is intimidating sometimes, isn't it? When the whole world says he doesn't exist, so his standards don't apply here. That could be intimidating for people who are not beholding the God that I follow. When we spend our days beholding God, knowing God, whatever they say doesn't count. Whatever they say won't overwhelm you because you are so overwhelmed by what you're looking at over here. We need to be a people in this season, in this time of our lives, in our families right now, in our families right now, in our ministry as a church. We need to become a people where we are so convinced of who God is in our lives. Amen? We need to be convinced, fully convinced, that He is good, He is merciful, He is gracious, He forgives. We need to be fully convinced, because if we're not fully convinced, we cannot convince other people about that. Amen? So beholding, we become what we behold. You have heard this many times. You become what you behold. What you look at, you absorb. I remember a few weeks ago, I got so interested with RVs, you know, the trailer, RV trailers. And Pastor Shell was telling me, why is the sudden interest in an RV? And I was telling this to you 12 years ago and you didn't pay attention. And now, suddenly you're ratting about RVs. And I was so beholden, I was so captured by an RV that I started going out to places where there's RV and start checking them out. Okay, I took my son Ian one time and went and said, ooh, let's take pictures inside an RV. But for 12 years, they were just there. You know, they passed me by. Ah. I see them. Oh. But I don't know, suddenly there's an awakening in my heart for an RV. And when something gets awakened inside you after a long, long time, you start doing something, you start being captivated by it. Amen. When you are captivated by something, it draws time out of you. It draws commitment out of you. It draws energy out of you. Amen. When you are when something captures your attention, it becomes the most spectacular thing for you, and you become like it. You know, I didn't become an RV, but my energy and my time and my focus and my concentration, my Googling, went on RVs. I didn't buy one yet, okay? But my point is this. Whatever, we become what we behold. So many times we have beheld things other than the person of Jesus Christ. Amen? We beheld, we were taken captive by other things. We were taken captive by what's going on around us. We were taken captive by what's wrong with him. Captive by what's wrong with her. And we are good in beholding those things. And when we start beholding those things, they do something inside your heart. And no matter how much you want to get free, no matter how much you want to shake it off, you can't. Anybody here who? And God is telling us right now that the only way out of that is to switch your attention to Him. When you start focusing on Him, all those things that has captured you, that drew time out of you, that wasted your days, that has wasted your energy, that has wasted your life, they start falling apart. Because you are drawn to the person. You start beholding the person of Jesus Christ. You know, Moses beheld God. And one time, you know the story, you've seen it in the movies, you've heard it in the stories. He beheld God so long that his face started to shine and the people couldn't look at him. Right? His glory. And then after a few days, that glory faded. His face returned back to normal. And people could look at him again. But the Bible says that the glory that we behold is not fading. It's something that changes us from glory to glory to glory to glory. Amen? We become what we behold. Can you switch it, please? After beholding the person of Jesus, in Jesus is mercy, in Jesus is grace, in Jesus is faithfulness. Okay? Behold, be captivated. Don't miss Him. Don't miss His person. Don't miss His character. He's not just a church guy. Amen. I know we talk about Him in the church, but He doesn't stay here in the church. He's so actively with you. He wants to be involved with your life when you go out. When you talk to people, when you talk to your wife, when you talk to your kids, when you talk to your coworkers, He wants to be there for you. Behold Him. Let him captivate your heart. Amen. Because you know what? Something great is going to happen. Something great is going to follow when we switch our attention from the people around us, from what's going on inside us, to the person that is before us, who is Jesus Christ. Amen. Another thing to behold is, behold what He has done. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Say it with me. Okay. We need to say it louder, okay? Like, we really mean it. We need to say it like we're not hungry for Lubies right now, okay? We're going to say it loud, like, all together, behold, okay? Let me see. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. All things have passed away.
Behold!
All things have become new. Amen? Have you ever been captured and been captivated by something new? When something is new, you like it. You like the freshness of a new car, right? You like the scent of a new car. You like the feel of the fabric of new clothes, right? You like wearing shoes. Some of us, when we buy shoes, we wear them right away, and we leave the old shoes at Foot Locker already and deal with the issue of fungus and all that. Because there is something great about something new that we love to have and we love to love. But sometimes there is something new that we miss loving. And that is the newness of life that is inside you and me. Amen? God, He said, behold, look, don't miss this. I've made all things new inside you already. The old you, He's gone. Behold! It's an announcement. It's good news. Jesus said, behold! Martha, behold John. Behold Danny. The old things in your life, they're gone. Behold, old things are new. Why do you think God would say that in His word? Because He knows us. Because He knows that after we get something new, our neck, they have a tendency to look back at the old. Our eyes, they have that tendency to be fixed on what is old and stale. And this is not just a word for us when we first get saved, it's a word for us every day. That behold, we need to start looking in our lives that everything has been made new. We are new creations. We are not to operate on the old. The enemy of beholding, one of the enemies of beholding is what? Introspection. Introspection, when you start looking inside. When our gaze has to be on Jesus, when our gaze has to be on what He's done inside of us and around us, the new things, we like to introspect. Oh, what in this? I can't do this. I'm so poor. I'm sick. I can't do this. I'm weak. I'm weak. I fail every day. I can't get out of this mess. I can't get out of this sin. We introspect, and those are the things that we behold. And when we spend our days beholding those things, it becomes the outflow of our lives. Amen. I wish I can do this in Tagalog because sometimes it's hard to speak in English for me. What we have been beholding will be the outflow and manifestation coming out of our lives. If you've been beholding the pleasures of this world, that will be the outflow of your life. If you've been beholding riches and money, and we think money is going to make us feel secured and safe and save us in the last days, that will be the outflow of our lives. We will just be concentrated on working and working and working and working. We miss the purpose of God for us. But God, in His grace, He says to us, don't miss this, guys. Do not miss this. It takes a shifting of focus. It takes just a shifting of a look. Amen. Sometimes we get beholden by the mistake of others. And this is just strong in my heart. You know, since the beginning of the harvest plan, we prayed and fasted. And one of the focus of our prayer and fasting is families. Okay? Our families, the relationship, husband and wives. Sometimes we get so focused with what the other spouse is not doing or doing bad. And we start focusing on the Jesus who has redeemed the relationship already. So that when we start focusing on what the spouse did not do, what he's still doing wrong right now, and we fail to focus on Him, that becomes the outflow of our thoughts. That becomes the outflow of our emotions. Because we have been beholding these things. But God is saying to us, behold, all things are new now. It's that, that's not you anymore. You're not that bitter person anymore. You're not that unforgiving person anymore. You're not that sinner anymore. You've been made new. And whenever we say yes, whenever we say, I behold, that's when we start changing. Do you want some good things coming out of your life right now? Okay? And sometimes we talk about relationship goals. Okay, this is what we want. This is what we're going to be 3 years from now. This is going to be us 5 years from now. But then we forgot to include God in the picture. Okay? We just need to start beholding, because change starts happening when we start beholding God for who He is. Amen? Next slide, please. What we behold becomes the overflow and outpouring of our lives. Have you ever wondered people, how people, you know, they have the energy to serve the Lord. They have the energy. They're already doing a lot of things, but they're still serving the Lord. They're still putting God first. Have you ever wondered how people, you know, they can balance all these things? They're married, they're working, they have kids, they have dogs, They have husbands, they have wives that they need to take care of, that need attention and caring. Yet in all these things, they're still able to serve the Lord because they have beheld what God has done in their lives, and they fix their eyes on that, and out of that beholding comes gratitude. Out of that beholding comes thanksgiving, so that the things that they do now does not flow from, oh, I have to do this, I have to serve the Lord, but it flows from, God, because you've done this in my life, I thank you, I will do this for you. Because I worship you, I see how great you are, you know, God, I'm going to do this for you, I'm going to do this. That becomes the natural flow, the natural output of our lives. Amen. Next slide, please. What we behold changes us. What we behold changes us. What you look upon, what you fix, your emotions and your thoughts, too, will change you. If you fix your eyes on the mistakes of others, that's going to change you. Not for the good, but for the better. Not for the better. Amen? Are you still here? Or is your mind already at Golden Corral, across town, right now? Okay? I hope that your silence means that you're digesting. Yes, I'm digesting it, Lord. Okay? What you behold is changing you. I am a guy standing in front of you, changing in the middle of my lifespan. I am not perfect, and I guess you can say the same things. There are things in my life that needs to be changed. There are things in my life, in my attitude. Okay? I can get critical sometimes. I can get over religious sometimes. Just letting you know who Pastor Alan is. I can get lazy sometimes. Yeah? I can get worried sometimes. I can be a person who doesn't have goals and who's just comfortable with what I have right now. And these are the things that needs to be confronted in my life. And I don't have the power to confront them. So what I do, I bring them into the presence of God. And I allow Him to confront those things. Because in bringing myself in His presence, in bowing down, in beholding Him, His glory shines upon my face. It shines upon my heart. It shines upon my emotions. It shines upon everything inside me. And I start thinking right. I start getting perspective. I start changing. And I invite you to do the same thing. We are not perfect people. We can become better husbands. We can be better wives. We can be better children. Amen? There are things in our lives that needs to be confronted. There are fears in our hearts that needs to be confronted. And the only way that happens is when we allow the grandiosity, the might, the goodness and the mercy and the compassion, the life-changing power of God to come upon us. Amen. Next slide, please. We need to start looking inside and start looking unto Him. Amen. We need to start looking unto Him. Oh, he didn't do that. Oh, she didn't do it. It messes me up. It messes me up when He says that, Lord. Why did she have to do that? Anyway, Am I hitting a nail? Okay? Because I'm like that. Okay, we're all in the same boat. Amen? We're in the same church. We worshiped together a while ago, but we are in the same boat. We get messed up by people not saying things, by people not doing things, but if we focus on those things, they have an effect on the outflow of our lives. It slows us down. But when we focus on God, we don't get God like what Gabe always says, God, that is your problem, not my problem anymore. Amen? Lord, those people, they're not my problem, they are yours. When we start praying for people and putting them in his hands, they stop becoming our problems. They are God's problems already. Amen? But we fall when we start looking at them and we start looking at us. Amen? Next slide, please. Huh? That's it? I'm done? Okay. Come on. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. But let me close with this, okay? Some of you are sleeping already. Let me close with this. Going back to that word, behold. What if we take this word seriously? Yeah? Come on, listen. What if we take this word seriously? There are things in my life, in your life, in our relationships, in our money, in the way we serve God, in our finances, that we just keep going around in circles. That's why probably God says, behold me. Behold what I've done. Because he wants to break us out of that circle. He wants to start moving us up and healing us and getting us where we need to be, where we enjoy life. It doesn't mean we're perfect. It doesn't mean we're not gonna be making mistakes, but we enjoy life, we enjoy his presence. Bottom line is, how do you behold? We talk about behold, how do you behold? You know what? You sitting on that chair right now, listening to the word of God, you are beholding him. When you go to Sunday morning church, that's an opportunity for you to behold who God is. Amen? So keep doing that. When we worship, that worship that we had in the morning, we lift our hands, we sing to him. To the world, it's a natural thing. Oh, they're crazy. They're singing to a God they don't see. Oh, they're overacting. But to us, it's an opportunity to behold God for who he is. How many of you know that whenever you worship, that is one of the best times when God shows to you who he really is? His goodness, his grace. He opens your eyes. I can talk here for days explaining who God is. But when you worship him, when you get into that presence, when you yield yourself to him in worship, he reveals himself to you in 1, 2, 3, 10 seconds. How many of us have come to church? And I encourage you that this should change the way we go to church. That when we go to church, we sit anywhere. It could be at the back. It could be here. And during worship, it's just something that we need to let it pass. Because I want 12:30 to come here. When we go here, we need to take every opportunity to engage ourselves in worship. Because when we engage our worship, that is one of the times when we start beholding God for who he is. Praise and worship. I heard somebody say this. Praise. You bring an offering. You clap your hands. You dance. You shout. You jump before the Lord. That's praise. You bring an offering of praise. But when you worship, you become the offering. Have you ever come to a point in your worship where you have laid down your life and surrendered to him and you became the offering? I challenge you this morning. You want your heart, you want your lives to be changed? It's not a struggle. It's not an effort to change. It's surrender. We change. God changes us. He gets a good hold of us when we surrender to him. And we surrender when we worship. So when you come here, don't look at here. What we're doing here, just songs. Just singing songs and good musicians and good-looking people singing. That's the very bottom of it. But on top of that is worship. We need to be engaged when we worship because we're beholding God. When we open our Bibles every day, we're beholding him. So sometimes we get so hurried. We mentioned a while ago one of the enemies of beholding is what? Introspection. Another enemy of it is this: busyness. That we don't have time to stop by and open the book and gaze upon the beauty of the Lord in His Word. It doesn't matter if you're 30 years in the Lord. Some people, they go leaps and bounds in their walk with God. You know why? Because they spend more time beholding Jesus. If I am 30 years old in the Lord and I don't spend time beholding Jesus, nothing's going to happen with me. If you just got saved last Friday and you start beholding Jesus, a lot of things are happening and cooking inside of you already. Amen. We behold the Lord in worship. We behold the Lord in fellowship. We behold the Lord when we open the book. I don't know how to say this. Listen, I don't know how to say this. I don't know how to emphasize this. But it has to be caught this morning. We are in a marker. In our season, in your life right now, you're in a marker. And something is changing. Something is like, it's like waterfall going down. It's a great waterfall going down. And unless you grab a hold of something right now, you're going to go and fall into the rapids, into the waterfall. That's not a threat. That is God telling you what's going on in this world, in your life right now. So can we do this morning, that before we go, let's get serious with the business of our relationship with God. We need to be a people where we know our God, where we behold Him, where we know Him, when we behold Him, the outflow of it manifests as goodness. The outflow of beholding God in my life manifests as grace to others. The outflow of me beholding God is me serving the Lord with all my heart, being fruitful, being effective. Amen. The more we behold Him, the more we see ourselves the way He sees us. Amen. How many of you, like me, sometimes I see myself inadequate. I see myself not doing enough. I see myself, oh, I have to do this. I haven't done that. We feel inadequate. But when we start looking and beholding Jesus, we see ourselves the way we see Him. We are saved. We are loved. We are healed in Him. We are set free in Him. We are favored in Him. Amen. Some of us need to start seeing that. Let's all bow our heads. Father, today we thank You for Your goodness.